On November 19th, 1863, a crowd gathered to dedicate a new cemetery in rural Pennsylvania. Just 4 short months earlier, a tremendous battle had been fought there, and it was to be consecrated as a national cemetery. To commemorate the event, one of the greatest orators in American history was invited to speak, and speak he did. For approximately 2 hours, he held the crowd spellbound with his graceful and powerful oratory. He evoked the memorialized dead of ancient Greece. He condemned the hypocrisy of slavery in a free country. He described the battle in all its tremendous detail and tragedy. He cast blame on the enemy, spoke on national unity, cited great philosophers of antiquity, and he commemorated the brave sacrifice of those so recently departed. It is said that, quote, "Mr. Everett was listened to with breathless silence by all that immense crowd, and he had his audience in tears many times during his masterly effort. Nearly 15,000 had come to hear the famed orator." He was then followed by a second speaker, a politician largely expected to make a brief official statement. The speech that followed in the next 3 minutes, delivered by President Abraham Lincoln, will forever be known as the Gettysburg Address. Edward Everett's tremendous speech would become known to history as the other Gettysburg Address, and began a friendly correspondence between the two great Americans who spoke that day. But it would be a disservice to Everett and his astonishing life to be simply known as an also-ran to one of the most recited speeches in the history of the United States. His is a life of academia, oratory, philosophy, and public service. It is an incomprehensible list of achievement. An outstanding scholar as a boy, he was a voracious reader and entered Harvard University at 13, the youngest of his class and then considered the brightest in its history. Graduating in the class of 1811 as valedictorian at just age 17, he continued on to divinity school and briefly served as a pastor at the Brattle Street Church, then Boston's most prominent house of worship. It was a short tenure before he was offered a position as professor of Greek literature at his alma mater, a position that came with a 2-year travel period in Europe. He jumped at the chance. Once in Europe, he studied at the University of Göttingen and earned a PhD, perhaps the first American to receive such a degree. He taught briefly at Harvard before serving in the U.S. House of Representatives. Retiring in 1835, he was elected as the 15th governor of Massachusetts in November that same year, where he made numerous improvements to the education system as he had done at Harvard. After a 4-year stint serving as governor, he was appointed ambassador to Great Britain by President Harrison, who made the appointment at the advice of Everett's lifelong friend, then Secretary of State Daniel Webster. It was a post he served in quite successfully until a change of president brought about a new appointment in 1845. As usual, Everett was a man in high demand and quickly discovered that he was being offered the position of president at Harvard, which he did until he was appointed Secretary of State, until he was elected a senator of Massachusetts. In case it remains unclear, there was little that Edward Everett did not do. After his political career, he toured the country giving speeches and was well known for raising funds to preserve the home of George Washington at Mount Vernon. Already popular as a highly respected speaker, such exposure cemented him as America's finest orator. He was dubbed the Cicero of America and the Apostle of the Union. His fame spread far and wide for his powerful speaking engagements. In an era when celebrity was not rare, but media was, Edward Everett was akin to a movie star, a prestige confirmed when he was reluctantly nominated to run as vice president in the presidential election of 1860 against the eventual winning ticket of Abraham Lincoln and Hannibal Hamlin. Of course, with this level of celebrity in the mid-1800s, it was only a matter of time before he caught the attention of Samuel Colt. Well known for gifting elaborate firearms to people with the appropriate connections, Samuel Colt presented this stunning first-year production Colt 1855 Sidehammer pocket revolver to Edward Everett. This exquisite and historic revolver comes engraved by none other than 19th century master engraver Gustav Jung and bears on its backstrap the historic presentation, "Honorable Edward Everett from Colonel Colt." Young's work is abundant on the revolver. And despite the densely packed work on such a small canvas, it still bears many of his signature touches, such as hidden animal heads in the tendrils of the scroll and vine engraving. Indicative of such difficult and diminutive work, of significant note on the hammer are 8 punch dots, one for each of the 8 full days required for Young to complete this stunning revolver. It comes cased with a full complement of original accessories in remarkable condition, but the Little Root revolver rightly steals the show. The finish beneath its extensive scroll work is excellent and remains over 95% complete. The grips are handsomely figured walnut with essentially all of its original high-polished piano finish. It is a time capsule small of scale, but with a giant historical significance. As if its allure weren't enough already, it bears just a 3-digit serial number and is completely fresh to market. This newly discovered root has remained in the family of Edward Everett for 164 years. And it is finally available to the collecting fraternity, ready to make its grand debut at Rock Island Auction Company. Were this revolver being offered on its condition alone, it would rank among the very best. Add in its factory presentation and Samuel Colt inscription, it instantly becomes the things collectors dream about. Reveal its monumental historic recipient, and it enters the very zenith of firearms, those that can combine history, rarity, provenance, and supremely high condition. Edward Everett may not be a name as commonly taught in schools, but it is unquestionably one that has made a tremendous impact on our nation, especially as it inevitably drew to its greatest conflict. So great was his impact that just 13 years after his death, his image was chosen to grace the $50 silver certificate. There's no better way to summarize his contributions than was penned in the memoriam written shortly after his death. Is this man dead? Ah, no. He lives in millions of grateful, loving hearts. Is Edward Everett dead? He lives enshrined in the innermost chambers of the heart of his agonizing country as one of her noblest defenders, her wisest counselors, and her most eloquent avant-couriers of learning and liberty. He lives among the illustrious of that bright spirit land from which he drew the light for his resplendent life, and to which that life unwaveringly aspired. He did not die. The good can never die.